Yeah. Okay. Yeah, my talk will be or is about certain years in web front-end development, but don't expect it to be a scientific essay of the history, but more as an opinionated thing where I pointed out some dates which I found interesting. Okay, let's get started. So, the first headline would be Science, Tim Berners-Lee, and the birth of the web front-end and HTML. So, okay, why I chose Science? Yeah, that was because in 1990, the first website went online. And that was a good thing, actually. It went online and was made by Tim Berners-Lee, who was responsible for setting up an environment for scientists at CERN, which is some kind of institute which is responsible to do research while nuclear things do certain stuff. So, yeah. And the first website was made in HTML, which was a format which was good for displaying it on different operating systems. And he already knew that he invented a really cool thing. So, and this is why he spread the word in 1991. And he wrote down HTML as a standard. So in 1992, the first ever image was uploaded to the internet. 1993, the Mosaic browser was released, and that was a good thing, because this was the first browser with a graphical user interface. In 1994, the World Wide Web Consortium was founded, and Tim Berners-Lee was the leader of it. And in 1994, there was also HTML2 released. So the theory, now we come to a few examples and resources of that. So, takes a while. Come on. Do, 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 do. Of course, the internet sucks, right? Yeah, that's not actually a website, but this is the LimeWire browser, the first ever browser, the first browser who was released. So, and this thing is really a good thing. The kernel sets up a project where the LimeWire browser was the LimeWire browser is a thing that they invented, an emulator to bring this thing back to life. And here you see some numbers, and this is how you navigate through pages in the 1990s. So for example, if I hit the 5, I come back, and there's the next page. Cool thing, right? So, and the first, this is the first website you see here, and it is about how you write HTML, and how you bring websites online. So, another thing, this is the same web page in a modern browser. So look, this thing is beautiful, right? So, still works, responsive, works even on mobile. Cool, right? So let's get back. And now, a more really cool thing, that's the first image on the internet. And this is the CERNET, which is the band of the Kern Institute. So they performed some songs about Technik. It's really a funny thing. There are YouTube videos online still. Maybe you have a look at it. Cool thing. So the first image was a GIF image. The author or the inventor of GIF insists that it is pronounced GIF, but I don't think, no, right, it's not graphical image file, but graphical. Okay, so the next time frame, period of time, is labeled e-commerce, Brandon Eich, and stylish web frontends. So the reason why I chose e-commerce as the influencing field to push the web forward was because in this time period, eBay was founded, Amazon was founded, and the first item ever sold was online, where in this time period. And the first item ever sold was a pizza. And the first item sold on eBay was a laser pointer, but actually didn't work. So, fun fact. Okay, yeah, let's come to the hardest part, the theory again. So in 1995, HTML3 was released. Finally, we had an iframe. Cool thing. Mocha and LiveScript was invented by Brandon Eich. He did that in just 9 days. That's the myth. And that was because other technology should come as well to the browser, so like Java, Perl, all this stuff. And I am actually excited that he made it in that 9 days. And so today we have JavaScript to develop websites. In 1996, the Internet Explorer 3 was released, which was the first browser which implemented the full CSS standard and JScript, which was kind of a slang of Mocha and LiveScript. And the Nokia 9000 communicator was released by Nokia. I come to that one later, but it was the kickoff of the mobile web. Spoiler. So, 1998, HTML 3.2 was released and Google was founded. This is the reason why we have to do now search engine optimization, but also we can search the web. Cool thing. And the other thing is that the open source initiative was started. They care about licenses. If they look into a license, they say that's an open source license or not. So in 1999, ECMAScript 3 was released. ECMAScript 3 was used for a long time, and we will see why this was later. So like I said, Nokia 9000. So, I don't know if you see it, but here's a button called Internet, and that's where the fun began. Okay, and here, this is more a thing which comes in handy. Here you can look which tags are coming to a standard, like the A tag. We have it all the way from HTML1 to HTML5, and if you look here, so for example, I add up HTML2, you see, for example, that some tags were deprecated and we get the doc type and such stuff. I put this presentation on GitHub if you're interested. Okay, so next period, the influencing field is Web 2.0. And that's because in this time period, users became actually publishers to the web. Douglas Crockford is the influencing person for this time period. And yeah, like I said, web publishing for everyone. So in 2000, XHTML standard was released. This was because the World Wide Web Consortium thought that HTML was a big mess because they don't close text, they write text like they wanted. Yeah, XHTML. Not there anymore for some reason. We will see that later. So 2001, yeah, scalable vector graphics. Without it, no scalable backends. So in 2002, Internet Explorer gets the growth of the market share. That's an interesting thing because this was the first end of the browser wars. There was browser war between Netscape and Internet Explorer, so at this point, this browser war ended because Internet Explorer has always almost every user on his system. So CSS2 was released, and like I said, blogs and RSS were coming up where users became publishers. And in 2003, the term tableless design became a hit. So that was because before every website was just styled by HTML, so for the layout, and that was a mess as well, and tableless design was a thing in this time. So now we see why we have ECMAScript 3 for such a long time. That was because ECMAScript 4 stopped, and Douglas Crockford was one of the guys who had some issues with that, because for technical reasons, and Microsoft don't had any reason to introduce ECMAScript 4. So their browser worked, and they has had other fields where they want to invest their time. So and Firefox 1 was released in 2004, and that was the time where the browser wars started again. And Brendan Eich was who worked for Netscape was now at worked now for Firefox. Okay, yeah, like I said, here are the features of ECMAScript 4. You might know some of them or even more. Why is it this? Yeah, I guess because some of them are now on ECMAScript 6. So and here, this is a link. Here's the real story behind ECMAScript 4, and you might read this at home. It's an interesting thing. And two more things. This is the Facebook, if it loads. This is the original site from 2004, and I used the Wayback Machine. I don't know, somebody knows that? Yeah, okay, a lot of them. So, I look if I can log in here. The only user at this time was Mark Zuckerberg. I tried. No, I guess it won't work. Okay. Yeah, Google. I just want to show you the logo because for me it doesn't look right. It's kind of doesn't look good. So at this time. Okay. Let's go on. Yeah, like I said, this talk is opinionated, not a scientific essay. That's why I chose John Rasik as the influencer for web frontends at this time. And for me, it was a time where the web frontends get richer. And media was actually a big thing, because in 2009, there was a newspaper in Seattle which go full digital, so no paper anymore. Okay, 2005, yeah, we had the concept of Ajax. You all know why this is important. And we had the first ever video published to YouTube. In 2006, we had ActionScript 3, which was kind of a dialogue, a dialect of ECMAScript 4. We had jQuery and Zest as the first growing frameworks. And we had the release of the iPhone, which got the user the number of users which are using the internet on the phone increased the number of users, and the Chrome browser, which was added up to the browser was, and we had the first draft of the HTML5. This was because a group, a subgroup of the World Wide Web Consortium thought that the XHTML standard is not enough to build those richer web front ends. And we had the first release of the ECMAScript 3.1, aka 5 standard, released. Okay, that's a mistake. Okay, and what I want to show you is the prototype library. I guess no one is using this since 10 years, but the documentation is still online, which is a good thing. If you ever had to maintain a web page using this, this comes in handy. Okay, the next time frame would be labeled by digitalization and Steve Jobs and web applications. Yeah, one important thing, in 2010, Apple stops supporting Flash. That was the rise of HTML5. Firefox 3.5 was the most popular browser. AngularJS was released. In 2011, media queries coming up, so growth of the mobile web. Bootstrap was released as a CSS framework. React was released in 2013, and a game engine in the browser, which was an exciting thing. And in 2014, we had the release of the HTML5 standard. So, and I brought you some links again. I guess I won't make it through all, but I want to show you that because it's really a beautiful thing. That's not a video, but the Unreal Engine in a browser, which is quite amazing. So if you look at this, I really like it. And maybe you get relaxed a bit. I leave it for like 30 seconds. Cool, right? Okay. Now it's me again. Okay. So that's my last slide. For me, this time period is all about technology. So, and I leave a question mark there because I actually don't have a person for that time. And for me, the biggest thing at the moment is web frontend as an assistant. And so this is why I took Amazon Echo into it, because I think it's a real big thing that we can interact with the front end. So speech is a front end for me as well. So we have all these chatbots and such stuff, and I think it's a great thing. So let's go through the dates really quick. So in 2015, we have had the standard ECMAScript 6, and like I said, there were some concepts, like in ECMAScript 4, like classes, interfaces, and so on. No, interfaces, not right. Classes. 2016, we had the release of Angular 2. In 2017, Firefox released its browser with support for WebVR. HTML 5.2 was released, and ECMAScript 8. Okay, and here I got some resources. So the first one is what the web can do today. You might know that. You can have a look at it, and it shows you what your browser can do today. So, and I have three more resources about the dialog element, which I think will be a thing in 2018, because it will come to a lot of browsers, I hope. So it's just about making overlays without heavy JavaScript. The other thing, CSS variables, you might know that. You don't need a CSS precompiler like ZAS, and object rest spread properties should be a thing as well, because it makes the code much cleaner. Okay. Yeah, thanks. You find my slides at GitHub. Any questions?